increase in autophagy, that means decreased level of degradation of damaged organelles. Postprandial, postprandial means after eating, okay, after eating, levels inhibit autophagy completely. Postprandial levels, why specifically mentioned here? Because levels of insulin after eating are highest, isn't it? So as high as the level of insulin, as low will be the autophagy. And because the level of insulin is very high after eating, okay, maybe 2 to 3 hours after eating, up to 2 to 3 hours, the levels are very high. So that completely inhibits autophagy. Number 9, which will be opposite to this, this is decreased proteolysis, so it will be increased. Amino acid uptake forces cells to absorb circulating amino acids. This is a new one. Arterial muscle tone. What does it do to the muscle tone? It forces arterial muscle wall or arterial wall muscle to relax, thereby increasing the blood flow, especially in the micro arteries. So it may have, or it is having, a little bit of effect on causing loss of dilation. Why? So that the blood flow will increase, particularly in the microcirculation, in the micro arteries. These are all very new and research-based findings. Okay? Maybe you won't find them in books. 11, increase in the secretion of hydrochloric acid by the parietal cells in the stomach. Increase in the secretion of hydrochloric acid. Number 12, decreased renal sodium excretion. Okay? So most of the functions very easy to remember. Because on one hand it is causing increase, it will cause decrease on the other of the same thing. Like if you take glucose or if you take protein, very easy to remember what it will cause increase and what it will cause decrease. Okay? Easy? Clear? Now some interesting other functions of insulin. Insulin also influences other body functions such as vascular compliance and cognition. We have seen vascular compliance here. What do you mean by vascular compliance? Either vasodilation or vasoconstriction, isn't it? So vascular compliance is increased means it causes also dilation. Okay? What about cognition? That means the function of the brain, isn't it? Cognition is a higher function of the brain. It is related with intelligence and memory and learning and all those things. Cognition. If we read ahead, we will know more. Once insulin enters the human brain, it enhances learning and memory and benefits verbal memory in particular. Verbal memory, the things that you hear, or even if sometimes when you are reading, okay, that is also now not only going in the memory through your eyes, which is visual memory, but also verbal and oral, yani based on hearing. So you are, when you read loudly, when you are alone obviously, not disturbing others, when you read loudly, when you are studying, it enforces or reinforces your memory more as compared to when you study silently. When you are studying silently, only the visual stimulus is working. But when you study reading it loudly, the visual stimulus is there. The verbal memory, what you are talking about, because the brain has to construct those words, those sentences, isn't it, for you to speak. So that way the memory is going, and what, when you are talking out loud, you can hear yourself speaking. So those words which you are talking, they are going in your brain through the auditory system also. So through the visual system, through the auditory system, and through the language area. So this greatly enhances your study and your memory if you study by reading slightly loudly. Okay. Enhancing brain insulin signaling also enhances the acute thermoregulatory and glucoregulatory response to food intake. Thermoregulatory response and glucoregulatory response to food intake. What is thermoregulatory response? As you know, thermoregulatory basically, in the broader term, it means body temperature regulation. But thermoregulatory response in response to food intake. You know, every food or everything that we eat is having some latent heat, or there is another thing called as specific dynamic action of food. SDA, specific dynamic action. Without going into details, I will just relate it here and just say that when we eat or when we drink, our temperature automatically rises. Even if we are drinking some small amount of water, which is not cold or which is not hot, even if we drink just water, we tend to perspire a little. Have you ever felt that? Why do we perspire? Because our body temperature changes. Okay? If you have tea or coffee which is hot, you in fact start to sweat. When you have food, you start to sweat while having food. After at least half of the food is over, isn't it? Sweating starts. If there is no AC or if there is no controlled environment, you will sweat. Your nose will also start to run. Yes or no?
Yes.
Exactly. So these are the thermoregulatory responses to food and how to control it. So that is of course through the specific dynamic action of food, not only that, point number one. Another is through the sympathetic stimulation. The specific activity itself of eating, of chewing, okay? All these things, they are at that particular moment of time increasing your autonomic nervous system responses, I will say, in general. Isn't it? So all these thermoregulatory and gluconeogulatory response to food intake, suggesting that central nervous insulin contributes to the coordination of a wide variety of homeostatic or regulatory processes in the brain. Homeostasis and regulatory processes, they are also affected to a greater extent by insulin. Lastly, insulin also has stimulatory effects on GnRH. What is GnRH? Gonadotropin-releasing hormones. Naturally, if gonadotropin-releasing hormone from the hypothalamus is affected, that may affect fertility. Now let us see a little bit more. We have already talked about this, so we can go rapidly over all these phenomena. Effect of insulin in the muscle. What does it do? Insulin promotes the uptake and metabolism of glucose. Now normally at rest, the skeletal muscle cell is almost impermeable to glucose. Will you remember that? At rest, this is the key word. At resting time, not during exercise or not during movement, the resting skeletal muscle is almost impermeable to glucose. So what does it use for its energy needs?
For acid,
as you can see over there. Okay? It uses normal resting muscle membrane is only slightly permeable, or we can say almost impermeable to glucose, except when the muscle fiber is stimulated by insulin. So mostly muscle tissue depends for its energy need on fatty acids. Now under two conditions, muscles use large amounts of glucose. During moderate or heavy exercise, when you are exercising, and during the few hours after a meal. Like we have seen just now, the few hours, 2 to 3 hours after a meal, what about the glucose, what about the insulin levels? Are very high. Insulin levels are very high. So these high insulin levels, they will cause movement of glucose from the blood, not only into the cells of the body, they will also cause, they will have this effect on the resting muscle or the skeletal muscles also, and cause movement from blood into the muscle during the few hours after a meal. At this time, the blood glucose concentration is high and the pancreas is secreting large quantity of insulin. Extra insulin causes rapid transport of glucose into the muscle cells. Okay, the same thing that I have told you. Abundant glucose transported into the muscle cells is stored in the form of muscle glycogen. So is it clear? Effect of insulin in the muscle? Okay, so when is the muscle being affected? Loudly, please.
The glucose is increased and your muscle
will be fast. It will be stored in the form of muscle glycogen under the influence of insulin. Okay? Or no? Not clear. Effect of insulin in the liver. In the liver, what does it do? It promotes glucose uptake, storage and use. So this is, we are talking about the primary functions of insulin. Insulin causes most of the glucose absorbed after a meal to be stored almost immediately in the liver in the form of glycogen. Mechanism of glucose uptake in the uptake and storage in the liver. So there will be some enzymes over here. Okay, for uptake, for movement of glucose from the blood into the cells, the enzyme is glucokinase. You can remember like there is something called a kinetic energy and potential energy. Potential means present inside but not doing anything. Kinetic energy means actually doing something, moving. So kinase, glucokinase, kinase from the word which is moving. ACE enzyme, kine movement, glucose. So enzyme which is causing movement of glucose. What is that enzyme? Glucokinase. Okay. So glucokinase is responsible for shifting glucose into the cells. Here you are. Second is, naturally, what is happening once the glucose is exceeding the levels in the cell, it will have to be converted. It, synthesis of glycogen has to take place. Hence, the second enzyme will come, which is called as glycogen synthase. So, very easy to remember what it does, because glycogen is being synthesized due to this enzyme. So what is that enzyme? Very easy. Glycogen synthesis. It causes synthesis of glycogen. So first enzyme is glucokinase. Second enzyme is glycogen synthesis. Now there will be an opposite effect. What is that effect? Inactivation or inhibition of phosphorylase. Okay? The complete name is glucose phosphorylase or liver phosphorylase. Actually, phosphorylase causes splitting or reconversion of glycogen back into glucose. We don't want that because the glucose is already high. Right? The glucose levels are already high. We don't want it. So, it will be inhibited. What will be inhibited? That enzyme which causes conversion of glycogen into glucose, which is phosphorylase. Is it clear? Effect of insulin on fat metabolism. Insulin promotes conversion of excess glucose into fatty acids and inhibits gluconeogenesis in the liver. Insulin increases utilization of glucose by the body and also inhibits gluconeogenesis. When the quantity of glucose entering the liver cells is more than needed by the body, some of it is converted into glycogen. Now, the glycogen stores are also limited. It's not like it will keep on converting into glycogen and will be stored. There is some limit to it, right? So, after that, now what we do is we tend to eat more than our body needs. Isn't it? All of us. So, what happens then? The glucose that is being carbohydrate that we are eating, if it is more than what we need, some of the carbohydrates will be used for our daily activities. Right from metabolism to whatever we are doing. Some of the glucose will be stored in the form of muscle glycogen or liver glycogen. Now even after that, some glucose is still remaining. We are eating so much. What will happen to that? Now it is converted into fat. So you understand how we can maintain our weight or reduce our weight? Why the weight is affected so much when we decrease carbohydrate intake in our diet? This is the reason. Actually, the carbohydrates, the excess glucose that we are eating is converted under the influence of insulin into fat. Got it? So over here, when the quantity of glucose entering the liver cells is more, insulin promotes conversion of all this excess glucose into fatty acids. Now these fatty acids are packaged as triglycerides in VLDL, you know what this is, and transported by blood to the adipose tissue and deposited as fat. Therefore, in this indirect way, insulin promotes deposition of fat. So this is on fat metabolism, correct? What happens when blood glucose levels falls? And you must be knowing these two terms, hypoglycemia and hyperglycemia. Diabetics usually have hyperglycemia. Can they have hypoglycemia?
Sometimes.
Sometimes.
As the normal.
Yeah. But normally it is hyperglycemic. Glucose is released from the liver between meals, like when we are fasting, for example. When we are fasting, okay, we are not eating anything for a longer duration of time, maybe 10 hours, 14 hours, isn't it? So what happens after the initial 2 to 3 hours or 5 hours? How do we carry on? So you can understand the opposite effects like we have seen just now. All those effects of glucose being removed from the blood now will be reversed. Now will be reversed. So there will be inhibition of
insulin.
Glucokinase. Yeah? Yeah, of course, insulin will be inhibited, leading to inhibition of glucokinase, leading to inhibition of glycogen synthesis, leading to activation of phosphorylation. Okay? Is it clear? So very simple. All the reverse effects from the glycogen storage. So I did not tell you about this. Okay? Shall we go on? Activate the enzyme phosphorylase, which splits glycogen into glucose phosphate. Then there is another enzyme which has to act. The enzyme glucose phosphatase now becomes activated by the insulin lac and causes the phosphate radical to split away from the glucose, and then glucose is available. Now this point, lack of effect of insulin on glucose uptake and usage by the brain. As you know, brain is one of the very specialized part of our body. And another important point which you may be knowing is that it uses only glucose for its energy requirement. Brain uses only glucose for its energy requirement. It can use fatty acids, etc., but with great difficulty. It's very difficult, and in very late stages of disease and nearing death, etc., then all those things will start, nearing coma. What I mean to say is, normally, glucose is the only energy nutrition of the brain. Now, if it would have been insulin dependent, uptake of glucose, like it is insulin dependent in the rest of the body, correct? It is dependent on insulin. Now, if uptake of glucose by the brain would have also been insulin dependent, then our life would have been very difficult. Yes or no?
Yes.
Like fasting, for example. Like even not having breakfast and coming to the college without breakfast, you wouldn't be able to sit here. Do you understand why? Very easy to understand. And that is the reason why the brain and its uptake of glucose by the brain is independent of insulin. Not dependent on insulin. Why? Because the brain cells themselves are very much permeable, always permeable to glucose, always. Insulin has little effect on uptake or use of glucose in the brain. Instead, the brain cells themselves are very much permeable to glucose. And it doesn't need insulin to be present for movement of glucose from the blood into the brain cells. Brain cells are also quite different from most other cells of the body in that they normally use only glucose for energy. It is essential that the blood glucose levels hence be maintained above a critical level. This is one of the important reasons why otherwise the person goes in hypoglycemic shock, which is characterized by nervous irritability leading to fainting, seizures or even coma in extreme cases. So usually we have this when we are hypoglycemic, when we are around sala time in the afternoon, or if you don't have anything from morning till 1 o'clock or 2 o'clock, and our irritability increases. During fasting also, after Asr in Ramadan, people tend to be more irritable, correct? This is the reason why our irritability increases.